Good afternoon. The first item of business this afternoon is portfolio questions, and the portfolio this afternoon is education and skills. Again, I would make, as always, a plea for succinct questions and answers in order to allow as many members to participate as possible. And at question number one, I call Audrey Nicol.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government when the Scottish Funding Council's subject price groups for higher education were last reviewed.
Minister Graeme Day.
Presiding Officer, the subject groupings within the price groups were last formally reviewed in academic year 2017-18 with a group of sector representatives. The recommendation from that group to the Funding Council was that no changes should be made at that time, but the SFC is planning to commence a further review of the subject groupings within its price groups during academic year 24-25 as part of a wider review of its approach to teaching funding.
Audrey Nicol.
Thank the Minister for that response. I recently met with the principals at Aberdeen University and the Robert Gordon University and heard about the widening gap between the Scottish Funding Council price allocation and the actual cost or resource that's required to deliver courses and other activities. And I'm aware the transparent approach to costing methodology is an attempt to measure this across the UK and confirms a gap at an aggregate level. However, I'm not aware of any recent analysis in Scotland, although the Minister has just clarified when that was. So can the Minister confirm if consideration could be given to a fresh analysis of the cost relative to price on a subject price group basis for universities, as he set out already, to determine if the funding gap has become more concentrated in specific subject areas?
Minister.
So, as I noted earlier, the Funding Council is planning to start its review of price groups during the next academic year. This will be part of a wider review of its approach to teaching funding, and it will involve engaging across the sector and cover the point that the member raises.
I have a number of supplementaries. First from Liam Kerr, who is joining us remotely. Mr Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's good to hear about the review taking place. Does the Minister know, will the number of subject groups form part of that review? And if so, how will the Minister avoid adding complexity into what is an already challenging situation?
Minister.
As a point of principle, I do actually agree with William Kerr that any changes that we make should, wherever possible, declutter the landscape rather than further complicate. And I accept that the teaching price group model is rather complicated, so I would hope that the SFC will look at that actively as part of the review. But Mr Kerr will understand that he, like I, are not experts in this field, and there may be a sound reason for the approach that has been taken.
And supplementary, Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. On the allocations this year, the Minister will be aware that Scotland's post-92 universities, key to widening access and training for health and social care staff too, feel that there's been a disproportionate cut to them. So can I ask the Minister, what discussion has he had with the SFC on this, and what is his understanding of why this has happened?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, I have had a discussion with the SFC, and I've been in contact with the post-92 universities. Part of the issue in the allocations process is there are winners and losers. What I'm keen to do is to explore how we, government universities and the SFC, arrive at final allocations in future, because I do want to ensure that the sector, if it can produce a coherent ask or a set of deliverable preferences, then that's fully considered as part of the process.
And supplementary, Peter Swishart.
Presiding Officer, when looking at pricing for higher education, what measures, in addition to the Scottish Funding Council's rural and remoteness funding premium, can be taken to ensure that courses are appropriately funded and that the availability of courses does not come down to what's cheapest to deliver, which is a concern in my constituency, given the restructuring at UHI Shetland?
Minister.
President Officer, that's quite a complex issue that Beatrice Wishart raises. So rather than giving a quick-fire answer, I'll commit to either write to her or to engage with her directly on that subject.
Question number two, Graeme Simpson, who's joining us remotely. Mr Simpson.
Yeah, thank you very much. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on when a decision will be made regarding the Scottish Funding Council's recommendation to end the regional colleges arrangement in Lanarkshire and Glasgow.
Minister Graeme Day.
Second Officer, I've taken time to consider the Funding Council's advice and the practicalities and the implications of implementing any changes within the Glasgow and Lanarkshire College regions in the context of wider reform. And I think it was right to listen to different perspectives and concerns. But that process is now complete, and I can confirm to Parliament today that I intend to undertake a formal consultation on the future of the Glasgow College's Regional Board and the Lanarkshire Board, as I'm required to do, with my preferred option being to dissolve both.
Graeme Simpson.
Can I thank the Minister for that very helpful answer indeed? And I think as a follow-up to that, I wonder if he can give us some idea of the timescales of that consultation. And should the consultation end up agreeing with him, when would we expect to see that change in the current arrangements?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, we will look to launch the consultation in the coming weeks. I'm looking across the chamber at the convener of the Education Committee, whose busy schedule will also no doubt have an impact on this process. But if I say to Graeme Simpson, my aim is to have this completed in time for the next academic year. So that would be hopefully the process completed in 6 to 9 months at maximum.
Supplementary, Colette Stevenson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As the constituency MSP for East Kilbride, I very much welcome this news. Can the Minister outline the benefits that these new funding arrangements will bring to students, staff and South Lanarkshire College as a whole?
Minister.
I would expect, I certainly hope and expect, that the abolition of the regional boards will act as a spur to the individual colleges. This action is certainly one that the overwhelming majority of them have been pressing for. And I know from visiting South Lanarkshire College of the ambitious plans that the principal there has, were she to find herself freed from the existing governance model. And I have every confidence that particular institution will thrive under the changes that we're proposing.
And brief supplementary, Pam Duggan-Glancy.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I ask the Minister whether he agrees that there is a need for a coordinating mechanism on skills across the Glasgow region, and would he meet with me about what we could do to put something like that in place if the board were to be dissolved?
Minister.
Well, I say to Pam Duncan-Glancy, of course I'm happy to meet, but there is a coordinating regional model in place that we're working with around skills coordination, which those colleges in Glasgow and the greater area feed into, but I'm happy to discuss that further with her.
Question number 3, Fosen McGregor.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what consideration it has given to raising the school starting age and implementing a universal kindergarten stage.
Minister Natalie Dunn.
I thank Mr McGregor for his question. The member will be aware that I've met with Upstart and I was impressed by their level of knowledge and enthusiasm in relation to this policy area. In relation to what we're currently doing, since 2014, the Scottish Government has almost doubled the entitlement to high quality funded ELC to 1140 hours per year for eligible children, including all children who defer their school entry. The Curriculum for Excellence spans ELC in primary school and supports implementation of a play-based curriculum until the end of primary one, and I've had the pleasure of seeing this in action at some of the visits that I've had the pleasure of attending. While I'm interested in further explanation of a kindergarten stage, this would be a fundamental change in our education system and would require further work to understand both the cost and how this could be implemented in Scotland in the future.
Fulton McGregor.
Yeah, I thank the Minister for that response. Due to a decision taken in 1800 Victorian Britain to start children at school at 5 years of age, Scotland, and indeed the UK, lags behind our European neighbours, who in many countries start school at 6 or 7 years old. Can I therefore ask the Minister what assessment she has made of Upstart Scotland's research that nations that have already implemented the kindergarten stage have been rewarded by the greatest success in international comparisons of education and child development, and that a later school entry would help to close the attainment gap and address mental and emotional health and behavioural issues for Scotland's children? And will she join me in calling for a national discussion on this issue to foster debate within Scottish society?
Minister.
I thank Upstart for their research and continued work in this area. We know that high-quality ELC makes an important contribution to children's outcomes, particularly when they're growing up in disadvantaged circumstances. It's also critical that parents can make the right choice for their child, which is why we've legislated to allow all children who defer starting primary school to access an additional year of funded ELC. Now, in my view, it's important that we understand fully the impact of this guidance and our transformational investment in the ELC before we consider any further major reforms. Now, the final report on the evaluation of the expansion of funded ELC to 1140 hours is due to be published by the end of 2025. In the meantime, however, as I've said, I'm interested in this and I would be happy to meet with the member and Upstart Scotland to hear more about their research on other nations and what that national conversation might entail.
And supplementary, Rose McCall.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The benefits of good early years education cannot be overstated. It promotes nurture, socialisation, the development of meaningful relationships, help to develop a child's interest through investigation and discovery, promotes physical development, and develops problem solving, risk assessment, and resilience. So, in light of these benefits, can the Minister advise what other international examples have been researched? What models are currently suitable given Scottish anthropology, and how will they inform the Scottish Government's approach moving forward?
Minister.
Thank you. Well, our internationally respected early years practice guidance, Realising the Ambition, promotes play-based and outdoor learning and expands ELC and primary. And I understand that Upstart Scotland actually said if this document could be translated into practice in all Scottish early years settings, including primary one, Scotland's ELC provision would be up there with the Nordic countries. Now, as I've said, I'm happy to explore this further, and that will include looking at international examples, and I'm happy to discuss that with the member going forward.
Supplementary, Martin Whitfield.
Very grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer. We know that children are ready for formal learning and different changes and stages at different times, and that was the defining reason for being able to move the start of the school year. What thought has the Scottish Government given to how we can support children who are not ready to move on to the next school year further through their journey through education?
Minister.
I think Mr Whitfield raises a really important point here. We know that some children are not always ready to start school, which is why we legislated to ensure that all children who defer are automatically entitled to ELC. However, I recognise that this question goes further than that in terms of pupils that are in school moving between years. I would emphasise that we're currently undertaking an ambitious programme of education reform, and these are the kinds of conversation that we may need to have. However, in the interim, I'll ask the Cabinet Secretary to write to Mr Whitfield around the current measures or the support on offer.
And supplementary, Willie Rennie.
This is an excellent question from Fulton McGregor, and I'm fully behind this change. I think it's important we try and give support to the Upstart campaign. The delay of the formal education start, but also the introduction of kindergarten stage. Cocab Stewart, the Minister, has done a lot of work in this area too, so I hope the Minister would maybe be open to a cross-party discussion in this new spirit of the new government, to work together to try and take this further forward and gather the evidence that she's looking for. Is that something she would consider?
Minister.
I know that this policy has support from a lot of members across the Chamber, and I hope I've been clear that I'm certainly open to conversations around that, and that would include cross-party, absolutely.
Question number four, Miles Briggs.
Sir, to ask the Scottish Government what it anticipates the impact of the reported reduction in primary school music teacher numbers will be on children and young people.
Cabinet Secretary Jenny Gilruth.
Primary school teachers are generalists who are trained to teach the whole curriculum. Whilst it is for local authorities to ensure adequate provision of education staff, this government remains committed to protecting teacher numbers, and we are offering local authorities an additional £145.5 million in this year's budget for that purpose. The government has supported a transformation in access to music tuition across Scotland by supporting councils to eradicate unfair instrumental music tuition charges in schools. And the most recent instrumental music survey published in December last year showed the number of pupils participating in instrumental music tuition at a record high.
Miles Briggs.
Cabinet Secretary for that answer. She mentions protecting teacher numbers, but there now are only 37 specialist music teachers in primary schools across Scotland. That's down from 98 in 2008, and the first year of the SNP being in power, and down from 108 in 2011. Does the Minister share my concern that for a country with such rich musical traditions as Scotland, young people across our country will not be getting the same access to specialist music tuition as we did when we were at primary school? And what's she doing about that?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank Mr Briggs for his question. I mean, I think I alluded to my response in my original answer, which is that primary school teachers are generalists. And when Mr Briggs and I were at primary school, we used to have a system whereby we had peripatetic teachers who might come in to deliver music education, for example. They might come in to deliver drama. We don't necessarily have that system now replicated across the country. However, the government is investing in employing record numbers of teachers in our schools. And since the pandemic, we have put in significant additional investment to support a policy of maintaining teacher numbers, which I, as a former teacher, think is hugely important. I was at the conference yesterday for religious education teachers at Queen Margaret University, and they were asking me the exact same question in relation to religious education. I do think there's an opportunity through education reform for us to better support specialisms in school, particularly in primary school. And I see Liz Smith nodding, and of course this was a topic that we discussed when we both served in the Education Committee in the previous Parliament. So I'm more than happy to have that conversation with Miles Briggs. The question, of course, for the opposition is a matter of how we fund that, given the additionality that government is already putting in to fund protecting teacher numbers, a policy which I support.
And brief supplementary, Faisal Chowdhury.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. A 2022 National Partnership for Culture reports found that 73% of primary school teachers described themselves as feeling unprepared to teach music through their initial teacher education. The same percentage of primary teachers also reported feeling under-resourced to deliver culture as part of the curriculum. In the light of reduction in specialists highlighted by Miles Briggs, what action is the Scottish Government taking to ensure that primary school teachers have the skills and resources to teach culture?
Cabinet Secretary.
For his question, actually, back in I think 2012, Education Scotland published a report in relation to social studies, which specifically looked at primary school teachers' confidence around about delivering modern studies and issues around about political literacy. And similar challenges were expressed in regard to that specialism. So this isn't just about music education, although I accept that's the premise of the original question today. This is about how we can support better specialisms within our primary sector, recognising that these teachers are generalists and they are expected to deliver the totality of Scotland's curriculum. The major way in which we're going to support improvements to supporting primary teachers is through improving Scotland's curriculum. We've already started some of that work in relation to maths education through the curriculum improvement cycle, and culture and the role that represents within the current curricular areas will be part of that curriculum update, and ensuring we can better equip Scotland's teachers will be part of that process.
Question number 5, Marie McNair.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what discussions it's had with COSLA regarding the management of asbestos within school buildings.
Cabinet Secretary.
Local authorities have statutory responsibility for the control and management of asbestos within their schools. However, the Scottish Government have recently engaged with COSLA and local authorities on this matter. For example, through our recent engagement about the Health and Safety Executive's Asbestos Your Duty campaign, we flagged the risk of asbestos and raised awareness of the legal duty to manage those risks. I should also highlight that health and safety is not devolved to the Scottish Government, and the Health and Safety Executive has UK-wide responsibility for enforcement of the Control of Asbestos Regulations 2012.
Marie McNair.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. One of my constituents was diagnosed with mesothelioma at 30 years of age and is now 32. She believes that this is because she was exposed to asbestos in the built environment and strongly suspects this was from the school she attended in Clydebank. My constituent is a member of the Clydebank Asbestos Group who support the phased removal of asbestos from the school estate. Will the Cabinet Secretary agree to meet with me and campaigners, including the Clydebank Asbestos Group? The meeting will be an opportunity to hear the concerns about the presence in schools, and representatives of COSLA should be also invited to attend.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I thank Marie McNair for raising what I think is a hugely important point. And of course, thanks to investment from this government, the school estate in Scotland has improved from around 60% of schools being in good or satisfactory condition to today over 90% of schools being in good or satisfactory condition because of investment from this government. However, I very much recognise some of the challenge that the member has presented today. And I know the Clydebank Asbestos Group helped to provide that support and advice and information to victims of asbestos and to their families, such as the member's constituent. I'd be more than happy to meet with the member and with her constituent to discuss this matter with her in more detail.
Question number 6, Claire Adamson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the development of a digital strategy to help ensure digital provision supports the wider aims of the education system.
Cabinet Secretary.
As set out in the 2023 programme for government, work has commenced on the development of a new digital strategy for education. working in partnership with COSLA and ADES, we will establish an advisory group to support both the development work and the wider engagement across the system, and we expect to publish this in autumn of this year.
Claire Adamson.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. With rapid developments in digital technology, the new cross-party group on the Scottish Games ecosystem has exposed an issue around SQA college qualifications. The college qualifications haven't been updated in 13 years, and a college lecturer spoke at the initial CPG of the course that still talks about Flash Player, something I used as an IT professional over 24 years ago. Can I ask the Minister whether the new digital strategy will work to update educational qualifications in the games and AI adjacent courses so that the skills and education keep pace?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank the Member for her question, particularly in relation to colleges, and of course she will know that Louise Hayward's review, which published last year, looked specifically at some of the opportunities around AI and supporting the development of the new qualifications as part of our programme of education reform. I'd be more than happy to ask the Minister for Higher Education to engage with the Member on the specific issue in relation to colleges, but more generally I think it is important that our new digital strategy for education does outline that role that we believe digital tools and services play in the future of Scottish education.
And supplementary, Sue Webber.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Cabinet Secretary, the pace of development in digital is quite breathtaking, as we all know. So can the Cabinet Secretary provide clarity as to the actual delivery on the ground as to when classrooms and, importantly, teachers and learners will start to benefit from a digital strategy before, quite frankly, it's obsolete?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank the Member for her question. As the Member will recognise, as part of the budgetary process, I announced that we would invest £10 million to support digital inclusion for hard-pressed families struggling with the cost of living. As I understand it, that funding is being distributed to COSLA at the current time to local authorities, who will then have the power to make a difference in their community in enacting the types of changes we will need to support the new digital strategy. But incumbent, as well as that additionality on government, is the strategy that will sit alongside that and the actions that will help to support the development of the new qualifications. And to that end, Presiding Officer, I look forward to coming back to Parliament in the coming week to give a further update.
And question number 7, Cara Mochan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government when it will next review the income threshold for free school meals for those pupils not in a year where provision is currently free.
Cabinet Secretary.
Universal free school meals are available to all pupils in primary 1 to 5 and in special schools, and we remain committed to further expanding universal free school meals to all pupils in primary 6 and 7. For those year groups out with the current universal offer, we last amended the eligibility criteria on the 1st of April this year. This follows the latest increases to the national living wage, and the eligibility criteria were amended for families in receipt of either tax credits or universal credit. The Scottish Government continues to regularly monitor the eligibility criteria for free school meals to take account of changes in circumstances, such as further increases in the level of the national living wage.
Cara Mochan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. There is not one Labour member who doesn't share the First Minister's priority of ending child poverty. But the reality is, even given what the Cabinet Secretary said, in Scotland we do have children going hungry. So key stakeholders, including Aberlour, have argued that we could make further changes to the income thresholds for pupils in years where the provision is not free, and that would improve even further the access to free school meals. So will the Government commit to looking at how much further they could increase the threshold so that more families would be able to access free school meals?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank the Member for her question. The Member may know that I attended a roundtable with her colleague Monica Lennon on free school meals provision yesterday, and it is worthwhile again reminding the Chamber that Scotland has the most generous offer of free school meal provision across these islands. However, I think the Member raises a hugely important point. The Government does regularly update the criteria that we set in relation to the access to the eligibility criteria to free school meals, and we last did this in April. But I'd be more than happy to discuss this matter with officials, recognising the pivotal role that free school meals provision helps in tackling child poverty.
And supplementary, Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I wonder if the Cabinet Secretary would give consideration to, when we're discussing free school meals, to activities, morning activities with breakfast as a well worthwhile investment against the costs of issues like poor physical mental health, attainment, behaviour and hunger, perhaps even looking at putting out a pilot scheme.
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank the member for his question, and obviously he has an interest in this area. We've discussed it at length in the Chamber on a number of different occasions. I think that connectivity between nutrition and physical activity is hugely important. We heard, of course, the First Minister talking about his own commitment to running only this morning and the impact that has on his well-being. So I'd be more than happy to discuss the issue with the member. And in relation to a pilot, of course, I would have to look at my budget in relation to some of the opportunities that might present. It's also worthwhile saying the government has a commitment to run a pilot in our secondary schools in relation to free school meals. And perhaps as part of that work, we might be able to consider the member's suggestions today.
And supplementary, Audrey Nicol.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's very welcome that the Scottish Government remains committed to expanding free school meal availability. So can the Cabinet Secretary provide any update regarding what assessment the Scottish Government has made as to the rate of uptake of free school meals? And can she say any more about what steps can be taken to maximise uptake?
Cabinet Secretary.
Last year, our Healthy Living Survey found the percentage of eligible pupils taking a free school meal was 70.4%, an increase on the previous year. Plus, our pupil census data shows that over half of all pupils are now registered for free school meals. But we do recognise that the percentage of pupils taking a meal is still lower than it was prior to the pandemic, when around 76% of eligible pupils were recorded as taking free school meals. This fall in uptake partly reflects some changes in relation to eating habits during the pandemic, which saw more pupils taking packed lunches to school than prior to the lockdown. But as stated in my original answer to Carol Mochan, we remain absolutely committed to further expanding universal free school meals to all pupils in primary 6 and 7.
Thank you. Question 8 has been withdrawn, and therefore that concludes portfolio questions on education and skills. There will be a very short pause before we move on to the next item of business to allow front bench teams to change position should they so wish. Thank you.